Welcome to Introduction to MPI Part 2. My name is Paweł Pomorski. I am based at the University of Waterloo, and there's my email address. So if you have any questions after this seminar, you can always email me. This talk is a continuation of Part 1, so I'm just going to pick right up where we left off. So I hope you have seen Part 1 of this seminar 2 weeks ago. And if you are watching this recording, then I hope you have seen the previous recording. So in Part 1, we have covered the essential calls of MPI, which are listed here. So let me just quickly review them. We have the most trivial ones are MPI init and MPI finalize. These are just two calls you make at the beginning and at the end of the portion of your program which uses MPI, message passing interface. Then there is MPI com rank and com size. MPI com rank is going to identify the MPI process by giving it a number. So if you have 8 MPI processes, they will have numbers 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And then when you call this in the program, a process can identify what its rank is, and then it can do different things depending on which rank it has been assigned. And here we have MPI com size. This tells the process how many total processes have been launched in this MPI run invocation. So these are relatively easy, and you only call them once in your program, but the heart of MPI are the communications, and you accomplish them by these two fundamental routines, MPI send and MPI receive. So if you want to send some data from a process somewhere else, you call MPI send. And if you want to receive data on a process from some other process, you call MPI receive. So again, see Part 1 for full discussions of these calls. So the outline of this talk is I'm going to, first of all, introduce an example using these 6 MPI calls to refresh your memory from Part 1. And then I'm going to show how that simple example can be improved by using collective communications. And I will explain what they are. And then in the second part of this talk, I will talk about non-blocking communications. So these are two broad categories of functions which you need to use in your MPI program if you really want to write a good, efficient MPI code. So the example we are starting off with is numerical integration. So we want to integrate some function f of x from a to b. And the standard simple but effective mathematical technique for accomplishing this numerically is to use the trapezoid rule. So let me switch to the next slide just to illustrate this graphically. So let's say the blue line is the function I want to integrate. So I can approximate this blue function by the red line, by a series of straight line segments, and then I can calculate the area underneath the red line segment, and notice that each segment is a trapezoid, hence the name trapezoid rule. And if I make the segment small enough, then I'm going to approximate my function correctly with the desired degree of numerical accuracy. So switching back to the previous slide, so the picture I have shown you, the mathematical formula for what this picture showed is here. So we approximate our function f of x by its value at the beginning and end of the segment times h over 2, and then values in the interior of the interval times h, where h is the width of each segment. And xi takes on successive values within the interval. So if I did this on a single process, I would use this formula, but I hope you can see that this very naturally lends itself to parallelization via MPI, because we can take our interval, and if we are running n MPI processes, we can in turn divide this interval into n subintervals. So in practice then, if in a single process code, we used n points to approximate our function, if we divide it among p processes, we are going to be using n over p points or intervals to approximate our function. Now, for simplicity in this code, we are always going to assume that the number of points or intervals divided by the number of processes is always an integer. So the number of points we are using for our approximation is just evenly divided by the number of processes. If this wasn't true, our code would have to be made more complicated. So for simplicity, we are just going to assume it. So once we do this, this table expresses which intervals each process is responsible for. So process 0 will apply integration from A to A plus N over P times H, where H is, again, B minus A over N. Process 1 will process the next interval, and so on. So again, the picture illustrates the basic idea. So let's jump into the source code. And the source code will be made available after the lecture. In fact, I will do a quick demo showing how I compile it. But I don't want to jump back and forth between shell and slides. So I'm just going to do that at the very end. And also, the code will be available for you to download. And I will explain where to get it. So for simplicity, we are just going to hard code the function we want to integrate. So in this case, let's make it x squared, because it's nice and simple, and we know what the analytical answer is. So we define our function f for integration as x squared. And next, we are going to consider how would we do this integration not in parallel. This is usually a pretty good strategy for writing any parallel program. First, write a program which is not parallel, which just solves the problem in a single process. This is good for two reasons. First of all, it's going to allow you to check the correctness of your answer, because parallel programming is more difficult, so you can be more certain that the serial program is correct. And once you write the serial program, you can then write the parallel program and check whether things are correct by comparing to the serial program. But also, in this case, when we write the serial program, we are going to have a function which we can in turn use in our parallel program. So the function we have here is the implementation of trapezoid rule on an interval from A to B with n sampling points, and h is the width of each trapezoid. And this is just the code showing the mathematical formula which was on the previous slide. So we start off with our integral. We initialize the value with f of A and B over 2, and then we carry out the integration. So we integrate, we just loop over, you know, from point 1 to n minus 1. Again, we don't count the endpoints because they have already been accounted for here. And we increment at each iteration of the loop, we increment the value of the integral, and we end up with the result. So this is a serial function. So to do it in parallel, then, we are going to divide our interval from A to B into subintervals. Each process will be responsible for a subinterval, and each process is going to call the serial functions, which I have just shown you. Because from the viewpoint of each process, which deals with a slice of the interval, it just does a serial integration, and it just does a standard integration on this segment. Now, once each process is done, it then has to send this. It will send this result to process 0. Which will collect everything, add things up, and it will end up with a final result for the integral. So again, each process calculates its interval of integration. Then each process estimates what its integral is. And then each process which is non-zero then sends its integral to process 0. And then process 0 processes the final result. So we started our code with the usual include lines necessary to make MPI compile. And in our program, in this example, we hard code things. So the endpoints of our integration are hard coded here. So A is 0 and B is 1. We have how many trapezoids? 1024. Again, the number of processes has to divide evenly the number of trapezoids. Then we define h. This will be trapezoid base length. And local a, local b, local n, these are the local integration values. So this is the actual values which each process uses for the integration. Float will store the result on each process for the integration. Total, which will only be relevant on process 0, will store the total integral. And we also have variables for identifying the source and the destination for the communications. And the tag will be 0 in this case, and that's fine. As we will see, we can use the same tag. The program now starts. We call MPI init. This initializes MPI. We call MPI com rank. This lets each process know which rank it has among the MPI processes. And we call comSize. This indicates how many total processes there are. Next, we have to figure out the length of each trapezoid. So this is B minus A divided by M. So this is the size of the trapezoid using the integration. And now we are dividing the work among processes. So each process doesn't have to process all of the n's. It only has to treat n over p trapezoids. So this then becomes local n. And then we compute local a and local b. These are the local limits of integration. So this is what this is the subinterval that each process is responsible for. So once we have calculated these, we call the trapezoid rule, the serial function which we have written, and each process just computes the integral from local A to local B using local N trapezoids. So at this point of the code, each process has finished its computation and it has part of the answer. But now the answer from each process has to be collected on process zero and summed up and then printed, and this will be the final answer. So how do we set up this communication? Well, in this case, process zero just has to receive the data from all the other processes. So this part of the code is invoked if we are on process zero, if it's running on process zero. So if my rank is zero, process zero initializes the total value. Now note that process zero has done some work. Process zero has computed part of the integral. So it takes the value it has itself computed and stores it in total. And now process zero loops over all the other processes. So we have a for loop over sources where we go from source one to source p minus one. And we call MPI receive. So process zero now receives information from process source, where source ranges from one to p minus one. And what it receives is a single floating point number. So one floating point number. And it stores it in the integral buffer, which it can use because it has already, whatever value it had in its own integral, it has already added that put its contribution in the total. So now it receives the value of the integral from all the other processes. It prints it as a check just to make sure that everything has worked. And then it increments total with that value. So it adds integral to total, and then it has an updated total value. So this is what happens on process zero. And the other processes, so this is the else, this will be executed on all the processes which are not zero. These are processes which need to send the information to process zero. So this process here calls MPI send, where it sends its value of the integral, which is just one floating point number. And this goes to the destination. And notice that destination is just zero always, because everything, all the other non-zero processes send to process zero. And so once we get to here, the communications are done, and the result just needs to be printed. And the result, the total, only exists on process zero, so we call if my rank is zero, so this only gets executed on process zero. And at this point, we print the total result, the value in total, and then we call MPI finalize. So this is how you would do integration. Just notice that all we have used here are the six basic MPI calls, which I have introduced earlier. So initialize, finalize, rank, and size, and then receive and send. And in principle, you can just use those six calls to write MPI programs. But as I will show you in the rest of this talk, to write cleaner and more efficient MPI programs, you need to employ more than just these six. So the first concept we'll cover is collective communications. So collective communications involves all the processes and the communicators. So for our purposes, a collective communication just involves all the processes that you have started your MPI run with. And the ones we will consider here are broadcast, reduce. I'll talk about these in some detail. And then somewhat briefly, I will mention gather and scatter because there's just no time to cover this. So the main reason for this is convenience and speed. The broadcast is probably the simplest collective communications. And this is a situation where you want a single process send data to everybody. So you want some process to send data to all the other processes. So you would do this with the MPI bcast call. So the way the arguments of this function are, the first argument is buffer. So this is what you're sending. Then you have count and data type. This indicates the data type you are sending and how much of it you are sending, how many elements, which means that if you are just sending a single floating point number, you would make this MPI float and you would make this one. But you can also send vectors if you like. And the next argument, root, that's a fairly important one. This indicates to the process which actually has the data. So this is where the data will be taken from to be sent to everybody else. So on the root process, this buffer exists, and it's used for sending. On the other processes, this buffer will be, whether it exists or not, whether it's full of something or not, it will be overwritten with the data which has been sent. So I hope this is a fairly clear idea. I mean, it's the concept of broadcasting makes sense. You have one sender just sending to everybody else. So the way this broadcast works is it must be called on every single process in your communicator. So in our case, every single process has to call MPI bcast. That's the expectation. So if you forget to call MPI bcast on one of the processes, but you call it on some other process, then your program at this point will unfortunately lock, because whichever process called MPI bcast, it will wait until communication with, at least one of the processes, presumably the root process, when it calls MPI bcast, it will expect all the other processes to call MPI bcast as well. And it will just wait until it can see an MPI bcast being called at all the other processes. And if you forget to call it on one of the other processes, then the process which is sending the data will wait forever. So this is a key thing to remember about collective communications. They are collective, so they must be called on every process involved in the communicator. And if you are just using the default communicator, as we are doing here, then you must call MPI bcast on every single process that you have running. And yeah, so if you forget to do it, then your program will look at it. So, why would you use MPI bcast? There is some convenience because it is just a single line. Notice that if you want to exchange information with just MPI send and receive, your code is a little bit more complex. So if you have process zero, which is doing the sending, and everybody else is doing a receiving, you have to have if statements. You have to say, if I'm process zero, then I'm sending, and then if I'm some other process, I'm receiving. But MPI bcast is going to collapse all of this into just a single line, which is nice and convenient. But there's another reason beyond convenience, which makes it essential to use collective communications. To illustrate this, let's say that you decide I'm not using collective communications. I'm just going to write my own process, my own function, which sends some data from one process to everybody else. And this is illustrated in this diagram. So let's say I have a situation where I have some data on process zero, and I want to send it to all the other processes. So I could have a loop on process zero, which just does MPI send to process one, process two, process three, process four, and then the other processes just have an MPI receive. But if I did it this way, what would actually happen is I would need seven communication steps for this to occur. So since I have a loop, I would have to send to process one, then process two, then process three, then process four, five, six, seven. And this would scale as, the length of time it will take is the number of processes I have to communicate with. So it scales linearly with the number of processes. But what if we implemented this communication like this? What if in the first step, process zero sends to process one? Then in the next step, process zero sends to process two, but since process one already has the data, process one can also send it somewhere, right? So it can send it to process four. So in step one, we double the number of processes which have the data. And in the next step, we quadruple the number of processes which have the data. And then in the next step, we can double the number of processes which have the data again. So I hope you can see the idea that instead of doing this simple approach, we can make a more efficient approach which scales better. And this is the main advantage of collective communications. You can always assume that a collective communication, it is actually a library call which has some highly efficient implementation of the operation you want to accomplish. And this operation is likely to be much more efficient than any code which you yourself have written. And this is typically the case with all libraries which you're going to use. So the main upshot is you want to use collective communications for convenience and for speed. So to illustrate the use of broadcast, let's introduce a little bit more flexibility to our trapezoidal integration. Let's say that we don't want to hardwire the integration. We don't want to say A is equal to 0 and B is equal to 1 at the beginning in the program, but we actually want to read this as input from user. Well, input in MPI programs is a little bit tricky because, well, if you have 8 processes running at the same time, who is going to do the input? I mean, you cannot just, you know, if you just have an input statement in your program, then it's going to be executed 8 times and things will just get very confusing and will probably not work, in fact. So what you want to do is you want process, only one of the processes to handle the input. So let's make it process 0. So in this function, I'm going to have process 0 call it, read the input from standard input, from the command, you know, from the user entering from the keyboard, and then send it to all the other processes using MPI bcast, using the broadcast. So this is what the code looks like. We have a get data call. So get data has arguments A, B, and N, and also my rank. My rank has to be given because this will be needed in the broadcast. And then we have an if statement. So if this is called on process 0, then we print some prompt to the user, and we read from input values of A, B, and N. And then we have 3 broadcast calls where we broadcast A, B, and N to all the processes. So notice these are collective communications, so this function getData, it will have to be called on all the processes you have. If you forget to do it, then your program will lock. And notice how simple things have become. These are just 3 lines, so we don't need to loop over all the processes. We don't have any if statements around this, so we have exactly the same code being executed on all the processes. But the key thing is this number. So this is the root. This indicates which process actually has the data. In this case, it's process 0. So this indicates to everybody who is calling it that then this is the source of the data where the data has to be obtained from. So this is broadcast, but we can now simplify our code further. Notice that we had the data collection stage where we had a loop where process 0 would loop over all the other processes and receive their portion of the integral from them, and the other process would have to do a MPI send. And it involved a loop and involved if statements, and it was rather inconvenient. Wouldn't it be nicer if we could do everything, that whole procedure in one line? And we can using MPI reduce. So what MPI reduce does is when you call this, you have some data in the send buffer, which is, so this is significant at the processes which are doing the send. So basically all processes, because even the root process is going to send to itself. But the receive buffer, so where the data is being collected, this is significant only at root. So root is the process, in this case process 0, which collects the data. We have count and data type, so this is what we are sending, the data type, and count is how much of it we are sending. We can also define the operation we want. In our case, for the integral, we will want to sum things up, so we will have MPI sum. But you can also have other typical reduce operations, like, for example, MPI min, where you can take the minimum of the data. And root is the rank of the process where the data will be collected. Com is the communicator. In our case, it's just a default, so I won't be saying much about communicators in this talk, but in this case, it's just a default communicator, which means everybody. So again, this must be called by all the processes, but the result is only available in the root process, which in this case is where we need it, because we just need to print it out. So let's look at our modified code, which uses MPI reduce. So we start off as we did before. This is the version of the code where we read the data from the command line. So we called getToData, getData2, the function I defined before. And here each process computes the integral that it's responsible for, storing the value in the integral variable. And then the entire communication, which before involved a loop and an if statement, is accomplished in just this one line, MPI reduce. So we call MPI reduce, and let's work through the arguments again, just to understand them more clearly. So the first argument is the integral. This is what is being sent, and this is different on each process. So this is this integral value which has been computed on each process. Second argument is total. So this will be the sum total of all these values. And this value will only exist on process zero, the root, which is here. So this is where the data is being collected. So this variable, even though it's defined on the other processes, I mean, even though it's been declared, its value will be undefined. So you should not use this value further down in the code except on process zero. Then we have MPI sum. We are taking the sum of all the integrals. So that's the operation we are performing. And here is the communicator, MPI com world. Again, I'm not getting into communicator, so I'm just using the default one, MPI com world. And this just says all the processes you have, just all the processes you have launched. So this is a collective communication. It has to be called on all the processes. Once it has been completed, we want to print the result. So I have an if statement. If my rank is zero, then I print the total, and I call finalize. So I hope you can see that our code has now become much more simple. We have accomplished in one line what took many lines before, and this is very good. It makes your code easier to read. It also means there's fewer bugs, because it's harder to make a mistake in one line than in multiple lines, at least, hopefully. There's a variant of reduce. What if you actually do want the result of this integration to be available on all the processes? You can call all reduce. And by adding all to the call, you make the result available. Now, this involves extra communication, because once the result has been collected on process zero, it has to be resent everywhere else. This is why there is this distinct call, because typically when you do a reduction, you only need the result on one process. It will be wasteful to then resend it to everybody else. But if you actually do need it to be resent for whatever reason, then you can call MPL reduce. Now, very briefly, let me talk about two somewhat more complex collective communications, gather and scatter. These are very useful in situations where, let's say, you have some vector on process zero and you want to distribute this vector among different processes. And then the reverse of this, what if you have a vector which is distributed among different processes and you want to collect it on one process? So here's a simple example. So let's say that I have just four numbers. Let's make things simple. So I have x0 on process 0, x1 on process 1, x2 on process 2, and x3 on process 3. And let's say I want to reassemble these numbers into a vector of length 4 on process 0. So these arrows indicate sort of where the data is going. So to do this, I could call MPI gather. And when I call it, I can go from this situation to this situation. And again, I don't have time to go into this. I will just show you these pictures, but I hope the idea, I cannot show you the actual, you know, order of calls in the function. But I hope that you will at least get the idea in your minds how this works. So this is what the gather operation is. And there's a reverse of this. There's the scatter operation. So let's say I have a vector of length 4. x0, x1, x2, and x3 on process 0. And then I want to distribute these values. So I want to keep x0 on process 0, but I want x1 to go to process 1, x2 goes to process 2, and x3 goes to process 3. To do this, I call scatter. Now, these are somewhat more complex operations, and it would really, really be tedious to actually write your own MPI code using MPI send and receive to do this. So these are really convenient, and you can get quite a lot done in just a few lines of code. So this is just something to put in your minds, but I cannot go into any more depth on this here. Okay, so at this point, we have finished with collective communications. So let me just sum it up. So these have to be called on every process involved. There's some more caveats. So the amount of data sent and received has to be the same in all processes. These come in blocking versions only, and I will explain in a second what that means. No tags are needed, so calls are matched according to order of execution. And these are blocking, but once each function completes its participation, the call, it can actually proceed. So, you know, this is just technical detail, so I won't go much further into this. Okay, now let's talk a bit more about communications, so you can understand a bit more. So the concepts I want to cover here are buffering is, what safe programs are, and then what are blocking and non-blocking communications. So what is a blocking communication? So let's assume that I have process 0, which wants to send some data to process 1. In the blocking communication, the sending routine will, when you call it in your code, it will return only after it's, you know, the sending has been accomplished from its standpoint. So in practice, this means that either the data has actually arrived at the destination, or it has been put in some buffer where it can safely wait until it has arrived. And then similarly on process 1, if I have a receive, that is a blocking communication in the sense that once the code gets to this line, it doesn't proceed any further until the data has been received. And the standard communications are typically blocking, not perfectly, as I will explain, but MPI send and MPI receive, you can consider them blocking communications. So MPI send, it sends data, but it does not return until the data has been safely stored somewhere. And then receive also waits until it has received the data. So what does this mean in practice? This means that your code can actually stop at MPI send and MPI receive. Now sometimes this stopping is good. You know, you're actually waiting for the data and you know, you cannot proceed past that point until you have the data. Sometimes it's not good if you make a mistake. If you don't match your calls, then you might stop at the line and the program just waits forever. But that's the idea of a blocking communication. It can stop your code. Let me also just say a little bit about what the message structure is. Every time we call MPI send and MPI receive, it's always you're sending some data and then there's some envelope which contains the rank of the receiver, the rank of the sender, a tag, and the communicator. And interestingly enough, the amount of data is actually not exactly a part of this structure. So when you're receiving the data, you don't actually have to know how big the data you're receiving is. You just have to be sure that you have a big enough buffer to put the data into. Okay, so let's talk a bit more about buffering. Let's focus on a very simple call. Let's say I have just two processes, and on process 0, I call MPI send, and on process 1, I call MPI receive. So if rank is equal to 0, I call MPI send, it sends send buff to process 1. And on rank 1, I call MPI receive, it receives data into receive buffer on process 0. So these are blocking communications, which means that they will not return until these arguments can be safely modified by subsequent statements in the program. So let's imagine that when process 0 gets to here, process 1 has not yet gotten to here in the code. So process 0 is trying to send something, but process 1 just hasn't called receive yet. What are the possibilities? What could happen? One possibility is process 0 could just stop and wait until process 1 is ready to receive. That's one example. Another possibility is process 1 could copy the message in send buff into some kind of a system buffer. Now the system buffer can be on process 0, it can be on process 1, it can be somewhere else, we don't really know where it is, but it's some storage space where data can be buffered and then can return. Or of course, in worst case scenario, things could fail, but obviously that will be, we don't want that to happen. So essentially, there's possibility one and possibility two. This is what could occur. So as long as you have space, this is a pretty reasonable alternative. So as long as you have a buffer on your system, then when you call MPI send, then you know, taking this send buff data and putting this in the buffer and continuing on, this makes sense. Because then your program can just continue doing other things. However, if the buffer is not big enough or it's non-existent, then you might have to stop and wait until process one is ready to receive. Now, the very important point is that a given MPI implementation is not required to have a buffer. So you cannot assume that buffering space exists. So you cannot write a program which relies on buffering space being there. And not only this, but no buffering space can be infinite. So you are basically certain that once you're sending data beyond some limit, it will just not be possible to put it in the buffer. And then the behavior will revert to behavior one. So then whenever you do MPI send and sending lots of data, your MPI send will always have to stop and wait until the data has been sent. So the important thing is, if you are really trying to write a reliable MPI program, you cannot assume that the system provides adequate buffering. In fact, you can't even assume that buffering exists. So here's an example where this can really bite you. Let's say you have a program where you have process 0 do an MPI send to process 1, and you have process 1 do an MPI send to process 0, and then you do MPI receive on both processes. So these are processes just exchanging data between each other. What will happen in such a program? Well, you have MPI send here, MPI send being called here. So if the buffering space is adequate, what will happen is that each program will just do a send, put the data in the buffer, and then keep on going. So, and then do a receive. And this program will not block because there's the buffering which can temporarily store the message you're sending. However, if your data is big enough so that when you do MPI send, it cannot be put in the buffer, well then the only way that this call can exit is if it can connect to an MPI receive somewhere else. But there is no MPI receive somewhere else because both processes are calling MPI send and they are both getting stuck in this case. And if you're both getting stuck, they will just wait forever to receive the data. And just to make sure this is clear, if I reverse these, if I had MPI receive first and MPI send, then this would be guaranteed to get stuck because a receive is always blocking. It always has to receive a send from somewhere else. It has to connect to an MPI send somewhere else to get the data and then proceed. So I hope this is clear enough. So what are the possible solutions to this code, this problem? Well, you really have to rewrite your code if you don't want to rewrite on, you know, buffer, on the buffer being there. You can do ordered send and receive. So we could rewrite our code to change the order of these to make sure that each send matches the receive somewhere else. But this will just make our code more complex and more prone to bugs and difficult to write. In fact, this situation occurs so often that MPI has a special function. It's called MPI send receive, which combines MPI send and MPI receive in one call. And this is highly useful, and I will show it in the next slide. Another possibility is we could do a buffered send. So MPI actually allows the programmer to explicitly provide a buffer into which data can be placed until it is delivered. So programmer takes over this responsibility. And when you do this, you have MPI bsend, which explicitly uses the buffer. And then finally, what I want to talk about in more detail is you can use non-blocking communication. So this is a communication in which explicitly the program proceeds while the communication is ongoing, until later on it checks that the communication is completed, and then it proceeds. But the important thing here is if you launch a non-blocking communication, then you must make certain that the data you're communicating is not modified until the communication is done. So this is a responsibility of the program in this case. Let me just quickly discuss MPI send receive. So this is a situation if you want to essentially squish together MPI send and receive two calls into one call, guaranteeing that they will not block. Well, you have this very convenient function, which just squeezes together MPI send and MPI receive. And these are literally just the arguments you would have to individual MPI send and receive functions squeezed into a single function. So I hope, if you look at this for a second, I hope it's fairly self-explanatory. There's also send, receive, replace, a variant of this. If you don't care about keeping the data you're sending and you just want to reuse the buffer to receive the data, you have send, receive, replace, which just has a single buffer argument. So to reiterate, you cannot assume that your program is safe. You cannot assume that there's any buffering in the system. So a safe program will always assume that there is no buffering, and it will run even if the system has no buffering. This is important for portability because different MPI implementations might have a different size of buffer. So you might have a program which runs on one system because the buffer is big enough, but you try to run your program on another system and it fails because the buffer is not big enough to store the information you're sending. So let me finish up by talking about non-blocking communications. So a non-blocking communication, as I said, what it does is it initiates communication and then allows the program to do something else. This allows overlapping communication with computation. And this overlap is a quite important feature of this because communication is generally slower than computation because information has to actually leave your CPU, leave your motherboard, go enter into a network. Sometimes it's a fast network like InfiniBand, but it could be just an Ethernet connection. So this is much slower than the computation happening inside your computer. So if you can, if it is possible, it would be great that if you could overlap the communication and computation. So if you need to send some data, but while this data is being sent through your communication network, you can be doing something else. If that's possible, you should definitely do it because this overlapping will make your program run faster. So a non-blocking communication initiates an MPI communication, and it just asks the system to perform it when it can while it's doing something else. In a non-blocking communication, it doesn't wait. It just launches, and the program can proceed. But you must make sure that you're not touching the buffer involved in the communication while the communication is happening. So you have to have some statement later on which verifies that the communication is completed and then proceeds past that point only once the communication is completed. And these are the wait routines which allow you to do that. So this is what a non-blocking MPI send looks like, and this is the letter I in the name to indicate its own blocking. This is exactly the same syntax as MPI send, except there's now one more argument, the MPI request object. And this is an object which we will be able to use later to query whether this communication is completed. And similarly, iReceive looks similarly to MPI receive, except now there's a request object. We also have wait routines. So these are the routines which allow us to check whether the communication we have launched has completed. So MPI wait, you provide it with a request argument. So this is the request object returned by MPI send or MPI receive. And also a status. If you don't want to use status, you can set MPI status ignore. And this routine will stop until the communication associated with this request has finished and the code will proceed past this point only at that point. So there's some variations of wait routines. You can have wait all, so if you're starting a bunch of communications, you can have wait all where you provide an array of requests and you wait until all of them have finished. More interesting is wait any, you can wait until one of them has completed before you proceed. And there's a related routine called MPI test, where you can actually test whether a communication has completed. If it has, you can do something. And if it hasn't, you can do something else. So it's not a wait, it's a test. And also test any allows you to verify an array of requests, an array of communications. So this is what wait all looks like. If I have a bunch of requests and I provide an array of requests and statuses and also a count indicating how many there are. Okay, so to make this much more concrete and hopefully more clear, let's focus on a very specific example where we are communicating among processes arranged in the ring topology. This is quite common in problems where you have periodic boundary conditions. So let's say, but in this case, I have process 0, which just wants to exchange data with process 1. Process 1 exchange data with process 2, process 2 with process 3, and so on. But then process 5 has to exchange data with process 0. So we have neighboring processes arranged in the ring periodic topology, if you like. Now, if I wanted to write a simple code using blocking communications, I couldn't do it, because if I have every process do MPI send, this is not a safe program. This program could block if there is no buffering or if there is not a big enough buffer to store the data being sent. With blocking communications, I cannot write a simple code that accomplishes this data exchange. So let's try, well, except with send receive, that's, I could do it like this, but let's, I will not use it in this example. I will use actual non-blocking communications. So this is what the code to do it in the non-blocking way looks like. I define four request objects, and actually four status objects as well, but these will not actually be used. And then each process figures out what its neighbor is. So for a process, the previous neighbor, the left neighbor, if you like, is rank minus 1. The next neighbor is rank plus 1, except what happens at the boundaries. Well, if I am process 0, then my neighbor is the last process. So I set previous to be the number of tasks minus 1. Number of tasks is the total number of processes. And similarly, if I'm the last task, so if my rank is num tasks minus 1, I set my next neighbor to be process 0. And at this point, I accomplish the exchange. So I call I receive, I send. These are non-blocking receives and sends. And so receive will receive the data into these buffers. Send will just send, what I'm sending here is just the rank, so the index. So each process sends its index to its previous and next neighbor. So these are non-blocking. So all of these, I call them right away. So when they are called in the program, they exit right away because communication is initiated, the program proceeds. Communication is initiated, program proceeds. Initiated, program proceeds. Initiated, program proceeds. But the problem is, well, if I wanted to print the result at this point, if I wanted to, I'm not actually using the buffer here, but if I wanted to, I have to make sure that I have actually received it before I do anything with it. So this is what I call wait all. So this is a barrier which will only, the program will only proceed past this barrier when it checks that all the requests objects here, 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, indicate that these communications are finished. Okay? So hopefully you can see from this that we have a program which is the same on all processes, at least these communications lines, so we don't need to worry about everybody calling receive at the same time, because this is non-blocking receive, so it will not lock up. And also, if in this case we don't have it, but if there was some computation we could do while this communication is happening, we could have put it here before wait all, and this communication could proceed while, and this computation rather could proceed while communication is taking place. And then when we get to the point in the program where we absolutely must be sure that this communication has completed before we proceed because there's some data dependency, we call wait all. Okay, and just a few words about MPI test. This allows you to check whether communication has completed. And this returns a number. So you can actually test, or rather, this returns, one of the arguments is flag, which in this case is output. So it allows you to check whether your communication is completed or not, and you can do things, different things, depending on whether it has completed or not. So just an example of something more interesting you could do with MPI, you could actually have somewhat non-deterministic workflow. So let's say you have a situation where you have a master process and a number of worker processes, and you want these worker processes to do some computation, but stop this computation and do something else if a signal is received from process zero. So on process zero, I do some computation in this example, and then after I've done some computation, which might take some time, I send a signal to other processes. And this signal is just sent via MPI send. But now the other processes, what they do is they initiate first a non-blocking receive. So they start listening to the controlling process. But then while they are listening, I start doing some work. And as I'm doing this work, every once in a while, I test whether a signal has arrived in my non-blocking receive with MPI test. So if the signal has arrived, I can break, terminate this loop, and do something else. But otherwise, I can proceed with my computation. So you can see that using non-blocking communication routines, you can start to introduce some non-determinism into your program. Actually, have your programs do complicated, have complicated dependencies between what the controlling process is telling them to do and what they're doing. Okay, so summary for non-blocking communication. So non-blocking send and receive can be posted, and the program will not lock even if there is no matching send and receive. Send is completed when data has been copied to the send buffer, and non-blocking sends can be matched with blocking receives and vice versa. So these are some further nuances. When you have a non-blocking communication, it doesn't have to be a non-blocking communication on both ends. You can actually have blocking on one end and non-blocking on the other. Okay, so we are approaching 1 o'clock, so I will just summarize. So I hope this talk was somewhat useful. This was a bit of an experiment to have a two-part talk. So I jumped into things fairly quickly, sort of assuming that people had time to digest part one. If this didn't work for you, then please rewatch part one more carefully, and maybe then the talk will become more clear. There's other parts of MPI which we haven't touched on, but which are also somewhat essential. We have communicators, topologies, user-defined data types, parallel input-output operations, and parallel algorithms in general are interesting subjects, and parallel libraries which implement them efficiently as well. But this is the end of the talk, and the recording will stop here.